विश्वस्मै नमः। ॐ विष्णवे नमः। ॐ भूतभव्य भवत् प्रभवे नमः। ध्यान श्लोक। ॐ शांताकारं भुजगशयनं पद्मनाभं सुरेशं विश्वाधारं गगनसदृशं मेघवर्णं शुभांगं लक्ष्मीकांतं कमलनयनं योगिहृद्यानगम्यं वंदे विष्णुं भवभयहरं सर्वलोकैकनाथं। 28 वर्स ऑफ श्री विष्णु सहस्रनामा। वृषाही वृषभो विष्णुहो वृषपर्वा वृषोदरः वर्धनो वर्धमानश्च विविक्तः श्रुतिसागरः। देयर आर 9 नेम्स अपीयरिंग इन दिस वर्स। वृषाही वृषभः विष्णुः वृषपर्वा वृषोदरः वर्धनः वर्धमानः विविक्तः श्रुतिसागरः। We can read the verse focusing on each of these names also. Vrishahi Vrishabha Vishnuhu Vrishaparva Vrishodaraha Vardhanaha Vardhamanaha Cha Viviktaha Srutisagaraha. Same names as Namavali. Om Vrishahine Namaha. ॐ वृषभाय नमः। ॐ विष्णवे नमः। ॐ वृषपर्वणे नमः। ॐ वृषोदराय नमः। ॐ वर्धनाय नमः। ॐ वर्धमानाय नमः। ॐ विविक्ताय नमः। ॐ श्रुतिसागराय नमः। Now let us try to see the meanings of each of these verses individually. Vrishahi means performance of a sacrifice, a dharma sacrifice. Vrishahi is a term which is generally used in the ritualistic portion of the Vedas. It means the sacred remnants, the leftover after the yajna function. Vrisha means the residual results gathered in the personality after each devoted and dedicated act of offering during all selfless sacrifice. Actually, Bhagavad Gita defines yajna as any selfless service, collective activity where individuals contribute without any individual selfish motive. It is done for common welfare, and whatever result, whatever benefits arise from the sacrifice or yajna again go to the community as a whole, not to any particular individual. Therefore, Vrishahi means one who is a controller of all actions and the dispenser of all results. In all individual, conscious, intelligent creators, the Supreme, who is the form of Yajna, is also the pillar of desires, Vrishabha, which is the next name in this verse. Vrishabha means one who showers, bestows, fulfills all our desires. The term Vrisha also stands for Dharma. Dharma is the essential nature of a being, without which it cannot remain as a thing. So its identity, its existence depends upon, associated with, predefined, predetermined with its essential nature. This is its dharma. For example, fire. The dharma of fire is to burn. The dharma of water is to satisfy our thirst. The dharma of a great man is to serve society. The dharma of the Paramatma is to take care of all of us. One who showers all dharmas is called Rishabha. Rishabha means one who showers great health, supreme devotion, and silence, which is enervating, which is uplifting. And this happens, the Mahavishnu gives to all sincere and genuine seekers and all faithful devotees. He does this by being all-pervasive. All-pervasiveness is the dharma of Vishnu. That means it is the essential nature of Mahavishnu. Vishnu actually means all-pervading, all-strident, long-strident, present everywhere. This name has already appeared as the very second name in the Vishnu Sahasranama. In Mahabharata, the Lord Himself explained to Arjuna. He says, because I stand striding across the universe, Kramat, Kramana, O Partha, therefore I am known as Vishnu. This is in Mahabharata 12th Parva. Upanishad states that Vishnu has spread himself and conquered all these three worlds. This reminds of Trivikrama Avatara, great Vamana Avatara. In three strides, he occupies all the three worlds. Here it means he is all pervasive. He is already present in all the seven worlds. He is present everywhere. Bhagavad Gita, one of the concluding verses of chapter 10, he concludes the Vibhuti Yoga. Krishna tells Arjuna, why are you asking all these questions? You don't have to really try to understand me in part by part, part by part. Okay. Very simple, I will tell you. Yachapi sarva bhutanam bijam tat aham Arjuna. That which is the seed of all beings is I am. Krishna is telling, I am the seed from which all the beings have emerged. He continues. Na tat asti vinastyat maya bhutam characharam. There is no being which is existing. No being, either a moving or non-moving being. Anything, nothing can exist without me. Na tat asti. Anything, any living being, it cannot appear, exist without me. So, he is all-pervasive Mahavishnu. Now, he enables the devotees. He has so much love for the devotees. He enables them to also reach his Parandhama. This he does it by helping the devotees to climb step by step, very gradually. It means Vrishaparvaha. Vrishaparva means one who arranges steps, small convenient steps for a climb. That means we can reach the place, reach the destination, we need very comfortable small steps without any too much of exertion. For example, it is like a means ladder. Vrisha means dharma. It is a ladder which enables us to proceed on a dharmic path and reach Parandhama. Ladder means a flight of steps that takes us to the higher floors. There is no other way to reach higher floor except by climbing the steps up, step by step. There is no lift which will take us straight to the top floor. Parvata means mountain. Parva. We know, we all know, Parvata means mountain. That word has come from this. Parva means ladder. It will take us gradually to the summit of the mountain. Vrishaparva therefore means a flight of steps on the ladder of life to take us to the ultimate reality, the eternal dharma or dhamma or a place. Worship of Vishnu facilitates a devotee's steady evolution towards the experience of the higher consciousness. Gradually, we detach ourselves with the lower and identify with the higher. Now, apart from ensuring gradual ascent of the devotees, Vishnu also shelters them in his own being and protects them like a loving mother. A loving mother protects the unborn baby in its own belly. So Mahavishnu is like that, Vrishodharaha, protecting and procreating all the beings. Vrisha, Udara means belly. Vrisha means rains. What God is doing is, by blessing us with rain and resources, He is taking care of us. Vrishodhara points to the navel. Actually, it is a psychic center in the human body. It represents all creative thinking. We all know that Brahma, the creator of the universe, is sustained, emerged from, is sustained by and held aloft at the navel of Mahavishnu. During pranaya, the creative power merges back to its source, and thereafter, upon waking, the process of creation again starts. So Udara, the belly of the Mahavishnu, is like a place where everything is self, everything is kept safe and secure and preserved during the what we call the pralaya. The creative power manifests itself and continues the creative activities from the same point of its merger, that is the Udara. So the point of all creation, during creation, the manifestations of names and forms, all the spring forth from the belly of Mahavishnu is called Udaraha. So he is called the Vrishodharaha. Since everything emerges, is also called showering belly, from which the entire universe, all living beings emerge. And Vishnu not only gives birth, not only takes care of the creative aspect, but he also ensures our growth and prosperity. Vardhanaha, he nourishes. He is the one who nourishes, nurtures all the living beings, at all levels of life, stages of life, everywhere. And this nourishing is both in a material and also spiritual aspects. The term clearly indicates that Vishnu is the mighty power that supplies all, provides all spiritual growth. It provides for our well-being, ultimately blesses all of us and helps us to reach the final stage of realization. Now, in this process, Mahavishnu himself expands, grows, Vardhamanaha. He expands in the form of the universe. At the time of creation, it is practically, it is not there. Gradually it manifests, it grows. It grows into the Brahmanda. From the Pindanda, we get the Brahmanda. It is ever growing. And he can grow himself into any dimension. It is infinite. So the dimensional movement of progress is called Vardhana. All the names and forms of the universe are ever dynamic. They undergo progressive evolution everywhere. Now, this immediately brings to our mind the Lord's incarnation as Vamana, who was a Vatu, who was a small boy. And in no time, he assumed the cosmic form, Virata Rupa. With this, he measured the entire whole universe in three steps of his giant personality. Now, Mahavishnu is involved in every activity of his devotees. But he stands apart, unaffected by the happenings of the world. Viviktaha. Viviktaha means solitary, alone. He is standing apart from everything. Like the waker with reference to the dream and the dreamer. The Supreme is not affected by the world of names and forms, its joys and sorrows, its passions and lust. It smiles and tears, though they all play a part in the self. So, Viviktaha is one who thus remains alone part in his own majesty and perfection, but simultaneously enables all the beings, the entire world, to function. And this is the called Maya, the world of Maya. In the daily happenings of samsara, in its births and deaths, he remains ever changeless and unaffected. Now, the relation between the Paramatma and the world is beautifully explained in this verse of Bhagavad Gita. Maya tatam idam sarvam jagat avyakta murtina. Maya tatam idam sarvam jagat avyakta murtina. That means all this world, all this is pervaded by me, all this universe, jagat, sarvam jagat, entire universe is pervaded by me in a avyakta murtina. I am unmanifest. Being unmanifest, I am spread everywhere. I am there. He also says, matstani sarva bhutani. The entire universe is in me. But na cha aham teshu avastitaha. The universe is living in me. I am not living in the universe. And I am spread throughout. Maya tatamitam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina. Matstani sarva bhutani na chaham teshu avastitaha. By me, in this unmanifest form, all this world is pervaded. All beings dwell in me, but I do not dwell in them because I am not dependent on them. They are dependent upon me. So this is the full implication of the word viviktaha. The Supreme, despite manifesting as the world, remains unmanifest. But how do we comprehend him? How do we know him? How do we understand him? We can do this only through Shastras. He is Shruti Sagaraha, ocean of Vedas, the ocean for all rivers of all scriptural thoughts. He is like the ocean for all the scriptural thoughts, all the Vedas, all the Vedangas, whatever you know, whatever has emerged, all scriptures, irrespective of age, language, tradition, beliefs. Ultimately, they all indicate a theme which is ever the same. Like rivers merging into the ocean, all these go and merge into the same Supreme Paramatma. All scriptures are like rivulets of thoughts flowing through different terrains of national character and historical climates. They are gushing to reach forward the ocean of perfection which lies beyond the dark sorrows of mortality, because that is the immortal area. That which is the goal of all scriptures is immortal bliss of Supreme Consciousness, God Consciousness, Mahavishnu. Verse 15, chapter 15, Purushottama Pati Yoga of Bhagavad Gita. There is one sentence, it says, Vedaihi cha sarvaihi aham eva vedyaha. How is it that I am known? How to know me? I am known only by all the Vedas. I am verily that which has to be known, which can be known, which can be known through the Vedas. Shruti Sagaraha. So we have come to the conclusion of this verse. We'll conclude with Shanti Mantra. Om Sarvesham Swastir Bhavatu, Sarvesham Shantir Bhavatu, Sarvesham Purnam Bhavatu, Sarvesham Mangalam Bhavatu. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.